So I think the first thing I wanted to say is I watched your documentary, which I'd say it's focused on Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu and how it helps people grow as individuals. And it just like, it touches a lot of different fields, but basically, sorry?
No, nothing.
So yeah, I really liked it. I think I'd suggest everyone highly to watch it. And I'm sure we'll get back to it soon enough about the documentary. But also what you just slightly mentioned in the documentary, and I know because we both know Francisco de los Cobos, that he mentioned that you used to do Aikido quite a bit, I guess, in the past.
Yes, like 13 years.
Okay, playing.
Really intensive, you know?
Yeah, right. So I guess we have a similar journey. And it wasn't, so you touched that a little bit in your documentary. It wasn't like the whole main subject, but clearly we have a lot in common. So I want to touch both subjects of your transition from Aikido to Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu and your perspective, like what made you fall in love with Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. But as we start, like the first thing I wanted to ask you is, could you say like a recap, like how would you describe your documentary about BJJ?
Okay, it's like a personal journey into the BJJ, and also I wanted to do it like, I mean, everybody knows BJJ now because MMA and because of the pro fighters, but there's something special in BJJ that they have more practitioners than followers, you know? In opposite of MMA. Mm. So I wanted to approach this perspective, like normal people, common people, you know? I really like a lot of that in martial arts, the common people perspective. It's really big and no one's talking about that, you know? That's the main thing for me of my documentary. I mean, I really go to my perspective. There's impossible way to do like a really final word, but I tried to do it, you know?
Yeah, I think you did a great job, and I liked it a lot also too. I fell in love with Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu as well, and I used to notice a lot of things which I liked a lot in it, like how it would help people develop and change, and the whole aspect of kind of it destroying people's egos and people becoming more humble. I spoke about it once in a while in my videos, but I never it was always in the back of my mind, but I never really fully like articulated it. But then when I watched your documentary, so many of the thoughts that and insights I had about Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, like I felt like, okay, this is great and this is great and this is great. You really touched all of those. So I was like, good job, man.
Thank you.
So one thing which I'm very interested to ask you of is, so we both used to be Aikido practitioners. We actually did it for a similar amount of time. And now you are a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu practitioner. I, from what I understand, you don't practice Aikido anymore.
No.
Okay. So I guess, you know, when somebody asks me that, I wonder if that's the same that went through your mind, where I'm like, well, I kind of practice Aikido in everyday life, but not like Aikido on the tatami. So there's always this middle answer. But so what do you think, because basically correct me if I'm wrong, but basically you quit Aikido and now you're very enthusiastic about Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. Stopped doing Aikido. So what do you feel made you fall in love with Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu after Aikido? Like what was that thing?
Okay. It's very practical answer, you know?
Yeah.
In Aikido, I was more fat because... You don't do the same exercise. I mean, it's really weird because in Aikido, you do a lot of exercise and And my type of body is going fat if I don't do exercise, you know? And when I started jiu-jitsu, maybe more at the beginning, I lose a lot of weight, you know? And also, it wasn't like the point of doing jiu-jitsu. It's really fun.
Yeah.
And it make me go in, it made me real better shape that I have before doing. So that's one.
Yeah.
The other one is that in Aikido, there's a lot of false prof. How do you say it?
False prophet. That makes sense. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I mean, in Mexico, I don't know. Kind of.
When I say Aikido these days, I try to distinguish from Japan versus West, or East versus West. But in Europe, from what I experienced, yeah, I'd say the same thing. Yeah.
So maybe not in a main. It's more like some of the characters that goes to do Aikido develop that. And it should be the opposite, you know? Maybe not the sensei, but it's really weird that there are some practitioners, people that practice Aikido, that the ego goes, if you don't control it, the ego goes like mad, you know? I mean, it happened to me. Mm. That's why I kind of know that feeling that, mm-hmm. Maybe you can move things with your mind. You know?
Yeah.
I'm exaggerating, but.
Sure, yeah. But I know what you mean.
But when you are practicing Aikido, there's something like you think that you could defeat maybe really child's thoughts, but you think that you could defeat a guy on the street. And. I don't know. Since I in BJJ, I don't want to fight in the street anymore. You know, it's not my need. I don't think about that, and it's really different. But I miss Aikido a lot, really. Sometimes mm-hmm. I surprise myself dreaming about class of Aikido, and I wake up. I have to go back to the dojo. I don't, because I don't have time now, but it's a really nice subject to talk about. Recently, I give a class of Aikido and BJJ together. I call some friends from Aikido call me, and I wanted to teach like a mixed class, and it was really nice, you know, because what I really miss about Aikido is a class when no one is talking. And going back to that, it was really nice.
So that was like how your Aikido classes would be, because I experienced both. Some schools would be very strict about not speaking, some would be just criticizing each other all the time. You're telling each other how you're doing the technique wrong. I hate that. I used to hate that. But so you were in a school which was very silent, right?
Yeah. And I really like that.
Nice.
Because
good. Yeah, good.
Gives you another kind of language, you know? Mm-hmm. I think that they do it because of that, because you don't have to think the techniques. You have to see the techniques and then put it on your body, on your body movements. And if they speak, you have to think. I think that they do it because of that. And I really miss that.
Yeah. It's just out of curiosity. Let's say, hypothetically, if we would put that same aspect into Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, no talking. Do you think you'd like that, or what do you think? Like, what's your gut feeling?
I think they won't like that.
What about yourself personally?
That's a difficult, because I think that activity belongs to Aikido, you know?
Mm-hmm.
If you change it, you will have to see, but I think they won't like it because the jiu-jitsu is really free, you know?
Mm.
What made me fall in love is that I was in a class and the sensei was teaching a technique and it was interrupted for a minute for some student, and they say, oh yeah, it's better in the student way, you know? And that's never gonna happen in Aikido.
You're right, yeah. Well, yeah, I agree with you, and it's you made me remember something. It's something I'm planning to make a video about. I haven't yet, at least at the time of us talking. I was contacted by a person who's training Aikido in Japan for the past like 20 or 15 years or so. He didn't want to go on record, although I was asking him to do that. But off record, we spoke about the difference between Aikido. Can you hear me well, by the way? Does that sound okay? So, we spoke about the difference between Aikido in Japan versus the West. And he convinced me, I had that feeling that it may be already different. But he convinced me, like, yeah, it's true. And sorry, that the senseis are very humble. But that's also, you know, that's part of the culture. I think that's the culture where Aikido works, because the people there tend to be humble already. And then you have those senseis who are super humble. They don't talk about, you know, the depths of the universe. They present themselves as, you know, I don't have a clue. You know, I've been doing Aikido only for 50 years. So, and the other thing is everybody does it in silence. And that gentleman that I was talking to, he mentioned about some people who are struggling with like PTSD, you know, PTSD, right? And then they would find that practice to be very healing. They like it a lot. And I think that, like, as you described, Aikido has that kind of very clean aspect to it, very precise, very clean. Like if you would add resistance, and that's a common subject we have with various people, but if you would add resistance to Aikido, it would already become very different. But the way it's structured right now, there's that ability to be very clean, very precise. There's a clear beginning, clear ending. Everything's very clear, and the dojos tend to be very clean. And if you add that aspect of silence, I can see the appeal of it. I can see like why various people would like it. And it's kind of, it does make it different from Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. It's just like, it's not like better or worse. It's just different. And I see how Aikido can deliver that. But I think for me, probably one of the things which is keeping me back from Aikido is something you already brought up, is the ego, which I experienced a lot of that myself, and I hate that till today. So actually, that's even like on my list. It's one of the questions. So you spoke in the document. Yeah, you want to jump in? Yeah, sure.
I just remember. It's just that belongs to the other subject.
Yeah, sure.
I just remember that here in Mexico, I haven't went to his classes, but there's a sensei of BJJ that teaches judo and Japanese jiu-jitsu.
Mm-hmm.
And the classes, they are like in silence, you know, and it's BJJ.
Hmm. Interesting.
But the thing is, that they don't win.
Yeah.
Do you get? So I think that jiu-jitsu has to be speed and everybody talking. So okay, let's go. I just want to tell that.
I appreciate you saying that, and it's kind of also makes me expand on that as well. And one of the things which, so you probably know that recently I'm on the. One of the processes I'm on is, I call it rediscovering Aikido, which is I'm looking back at Aikido and asking myself, so what are the good sides of it? Because I was so vocal about the bad aspects of it that I feel, okay, it's time to balance it a little bit. And in that process, in that journey, I spoke with some people, and one of the individuals, Christopher Hine, I spoke with him, and I liked a lot what he said. He's actually a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt as well as Aikido black belt. I think he's a black belt in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, definitely like capable. And he said, I will rephrase what he said or the way I understood it, but basically an idea I got from him is that one of the troubles with Aikido is that it almost tries to be too many things sometimes.
Yes.
And you know, it's what he does. And I actually feel quite inspired about what his approach. It's like he has a beginning and an end. He describes what Aikido is and what Aikido is not. And there's a point where he says, Aikido doesn't work anymore. Now it's time to do jiu-jitsu, boxing, etc. And I loved it. And I realized, you know, like if you take Brazilian jiu-jitsu, they don't add strikes, mostly no. No, they don't add kicks. It's like, it's on the ground. Jiu-jitsu is jiu-jitsu. It's awesome. It's effective. It's lovely. But they don't try to be anything else from what they are. Aikido, sometimes I feel it tries to be like so many things and ends up being almost nothing. So it seems like you agree with me, right?
Yeah, totally. In fact, I wanted to tell you that in a different, different words, you know?
Sure.
If you think a philosopher and a physics, you know, if you put it, I think the physics is the jiu-jitsu and the philosopher is the Aikido. Mm-hmm. So Aikido tries to be everything, not just in defending yourself, even in spiritual things. And it's like everything, like you said. And it doesn't have something of reality, but that doesn't mean that it has to stop. I think it should go on. Here in Mexico, they still teach you philosophy. Mm. And philosophy doesn't work like biology, no? But
sure.
in a way, it's still there. It don't have to be the end of Aikido.
Sure.
I think that's if you put it in American way of thinking. Don't get me wrong. I'm not anti-American. But
I wouldn't blame you if you would be.
So, no, I'm not. I couldn't because all of my culture is like really American, but if you put it in the, how do you say it? The win philosophy that you have to win all the time.
Yeah.
Aikido won't live there.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I also think you have to think the time when Aikido was created. It was a time that, Japan was on the end of the American occupation.
Mm.
So the martial arts were forbidden because nobody wants to teach the way of fighting, you know. But before that era, martial arts in Japan was like MMA, you know. You go to another dojo and they fight like maybe worse than MMA.
Hmm.
So Aikido was created in a cultural time that kind of fighting was forbidden. So if you think about it, the martial art that survived was Aikido and Judo.
Hmm.
And Judo is, if you take a lot of rules, it's more like BJJ, you know?
Mm.
So there is these two aspects of fighting and to see martial arts. So I won't criticize Aikido because of the time that was created and the needs that in that time have to fill for Japan, you know?
Mm. Well, if I would ask you, so what drew you initially to Aikido yourself? Like, what do you feel got you caught onto it? Because clearly you were caught by it. Like, you enjoyed it, because doing it for more than a decade intensively, there must have been something there. So what initially drove you to go there?
Steven Seagal.
Is that a joke? Or because it can be like, some people, that's the reality, well, you know?
Yes. I noticed because of him, but yeah. I was practicing Kung Fu at that time.
Mm-hmm. Any so particular style or just Kung Fu in general?
I don't remember the step, because I just did it for 1 year. Mm-hmm. And before that, I did karate for like 10 years. So I was on a trip, surfing trip, and I was traveling with a friend that was from Germany, and he started telling me about Aikido. Mm. And he was really good in the board because of the Aikido, because also in his hometown they didn't have sea waves, you know. And he practiced Aikido and told me that helps him to the balance. So when I came back to Mexico City, I said, I don't have sea here. So I went to a class. And when I saw the class, I was amazed about it. I saw people flying and all the technique and all the aspect of the culture. I don't know. I was falling in love, and I started and I live it till 6 years ago. Mm.
So what do you think kept you in it? Like, would you be able to articulate it, do you think, or?
The practice itself, in that time of my life, makes me like emotional balance. Mm. I think. Yeah. I know that people practice martial arts because they want to defend themselves on the street, you know. I know that Francisco is really focused on that. But if you think that, how many times have you got in a fight on the street? You?
Yes, a handful, but not like that many. And I definitely see your point. So, yeah.
Not many, no?
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
But how many times have you been practicing Aikido and you feels and makes you change your mindset of your daily life, you know? And I think that's really important, and that's really important to me, not the other aspect.
Sure.
Maybe because I'm crazy and I need that, you know? I don't know why, but
yeah. Well, that
keeps me there.
Yeah. Well, that still naturally makes me ask, so you still eventually leave Aikido to a degree. So was there a specific reason why you stopped, or what happened?
It really, the thing that makes me stop, it's really Aikido itself, because I went to New York as a Nushideshi. Yamada's dojo, and I practiced with really tough guys, you know, like Mike Jones. I remember that. It was like fighting, really fighting. I don't remember the name of this other guy. I don't know he's Asian. But he practiced Aikido like, it's really tough. Mm. And I was there like 3 months in a separate, in different times, total 3 months. But every time that I came back to Mexico and I start practicing in my dojo, it was like what is this, you know? I was really boring, and the Aikido really changed, and I really missed that feeling. So I went to a BJJ class, and I went and I said, let's see if I can do some technique, you know? But they kicked my ass, like, I can do, I make that tap, you say the
tap,
I can, I tap a guy with a Nikkyo, I remember. And they asked me, you know, what's that? And I told them how to do it, but they kick my ass. And at the beginning, I start doing a lot of techniques of Aikido because that was what I knew. Then I stop and I say, I have to learn how to do BJJ, and I stop doing technique wrist locks.
Wrist locks.
But recently, before the pandemic, I started to do Aikido techniques again, and it's really good. There are some techniques, depending what you like, but I do a lot of Sankyo now. Really likes me to do Sankyo in BJJ.
Well, you did speak about the ego. And like that's like one of the key subjects as far as I could see in your documentary. And then in the beginning of our talk, you started off by saying that there was a lot of ego that you experienced in Aikido. The funny part is, and that's what baffled me and confused me for a while, was that it's officially like the Aikido goal usually is said like Masagatsu Agatsu, true victory, victory over yourself. It's all about destroying the ego. But then you would see people who are full of themselves. And I think it's sometimes people speak about that in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, about the ego and like leave your ego in, as you enter the door or something like that. But it's not like, it's less talk and more practice, but the practice gets the job done. So how did that seem to you? Like how did that contrast? Did you think about that contrast of ego in Aikido and ego in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu?
Yes, it's like you say, in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, they don't speak about it. They just, I mean, I think that there are some people that never think about it, you know, that I came here to lose my ego. They just feel it.
Yeah.
It's not in their minds. And in Aikido, we speak about it, but sometimes you don't feel it, really feel it, you know? I think the practice in Aikido has to be really intense to make you go there. When I practiced with Francisco, we used to practice really hard and really fast. You could do it in Aikido if you go really, you go to a mindset that you lost your ego. It's possible, but it has a lot of physical aspect and also like a willing to do it, you know? But I think it's possible.
So what do you personally, because I definitely have my own answers as well, but I'm curious about your perspective. So why do you personally think that the ego does come across in Aikido from time to time and not as much? I'm not saying that, also to put it on record, I'm not saying that Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is sacred and there's no shit there. It also depends on the school and it depends on the organization and depends on the person. But still, like the general tendency, I also met some great people in Aikido, like humble and nice, but there's usually, there would be something off about some of the Aikido practitioners, and the ego was not rare. In the Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu I practiced and the places I went to, ego was much more rare. Like the goal of Aikido seemed to be much more accomplished there, of people being humble, especially like high grading black belts. I guess also too, I don't know, maybe I'm lucky, maybe I went to the right organizations, but I just met some really, really nice people who could kill me. Like there's a funny story. I lived in Portland, Oregon, at a place. I was renting a room at a place of a high level Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu expert. And so I would be lying there in the bed, and I would sometimes think that guy, you know, my roommate or whatever, like, you know, the guy who owns the house, he could come to my room, decide to kill me, and probably do it very efficiently in a matter of seconds, and I couldn't do shit about it. You know, he would kill me. But he's one of the nicest people I know. Like, I love him. He's amazing. And he, you know, he never boasts about himself. He's incredible. But he's a legit killer. So that contrast is interesting. But yeah, to come back to the main point, generally, I noticed much, much less ego in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. But so what's your personal opinion? Why do you think that a big ego is not uncommon for Aikido?
I think because of the, how do you say, hierarchy. Do you know that word?
Hierarchy, basically the same.
Yeah. And also because you don't really go to beast mode. In Jiu-Jitsu, you go to beast mode, you know?
Uh-huh.
It's like you become like an animal sometimes. And in Aikido, that doesn't happen. You are always like thinking and comparing yourself to the other guy.
Yeah.
And it's like you said, it's not a rule, you know? Yeah. There's bullshit everywhere. Yeah. Everywhere. But the practice itself, it goes, I don't know, in Aikido, there's more room to the ego, Yeah. So you come across a lot of times to this guy that told you, no, you are wrong, and stop the practice. I mean, come on, why they do that? And it's really weird because sometimes that happened in Jiu-Jitsu. You are wrestling and the guy stopped. Why do you stop, man? It really makes me mad that they stop to explain you what you're doing wrong. That's not good.
It happens.
If you're going to
as well.
What?
It happens
sometimes.
Okay.
Yes, I have lived that sometimes. When you're really beginning, you know, they stop fighting and they tell you, no, you have to do this and do that. No. If you're going to kick my ass, just kick it. That's the best way to learn, you know.
Sure.
And when you tap, I think that something in your brain liberate all your frustrations.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And that doesn't happen in Aikido.
Yeah.
I mean, you tap, you know, but you tap because you have to tap, not because the other guy is really winning.
Yeah.
I don't know what you think.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'll actually elaborate as well from what you're saying. It's something I considered, like, as I guess most people know, I spent a lot of time asking myself, so what creates the problems in Aikido, or what's the downside to Aikido? And one of the things I considered, I don't have a final answer for this, but one of the thoughts I have is, because Aikido is, you know, Stoicism, the type of philosophy?
Yeah.
So it kind of presents itself in a very stoicistic way. Like, you know, uh-huh. It's like stone-faced and everyone is calm and so on. And I think there's something admirable about that. But also, that's not how we really live. That's not how we really function. And I think probably that subject was kind of covered in your documentary as well. There's one guy who said, you know, the way you train and the way you deal with problems on the Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu mat, that's how you deal with problems in life. I noticed there's definitely a tendency because rolling on the mat generally can be very messy. Like, you know, it's chaotic and it just, your adrenaline kicks in and you're uncomfortable. And that's so much more akin to what we experience in life. You know, when shit goes down, it's like, I like to say that it's easy to be good when everything is going well. And that's a bit more like Aikido. You know, everything is like clean and precise and you get used to being, you know, calm and confident in that realm. But then shit hits the fan and you're like, wait, there's so much pressure. I'm not really used to being my Aikido self in this situation. And there's almost like a sense that, you know, I wish that in Aikido, sometimes they would give you that chaotic situation. And then you would have to work your way to being a stoic guy versus what sometimes I would see, unfortunately, I'm not saying everywhere, but again, unfortunately, I would see in Aikido is something that one writer described in a book about yoga, that yoga has a similar problem. You know, everyone is peaceful and nice, and the thing is, he called them pirate ships with white sails or a white flag, because internally they could be messed up, those yogis. Yeah. And I met those people. You know, they're actually not really nice, but they know how to act nice. But once they would be hit with pressure, once they would have a difficult life situation, sometimes really nasty stuff would come out from them because they're not used to functioning. They're not used to being calm in those situations. So I think that kind of feels like that's one of the challenges that Aikido sometimes is facing. So do you think that as well?
Yeah. I don't like to say that these are the rules, you know, because like you say, it's really... we cannot be objective in these subjects.
Sure.
But Jiu-Jitsu has this more parallels
mm-hmm.
things with the way that we live.
Yeah.
In like you say it before, and Aikido doesn't. Mm-hmm. Maybe if we were in Japan in all other time, and if we were Japanese people, it worked like a different way. Yeah. But also, like you said, Aikido in United States and in Japan, it's really different.
Yeah.
Goes to, I think it's like an octopus, you know? Grabs part of the cultural aspect of United States, and maybe there are not good things, like some dojos are always thinking of winning, but winning what, you know?
Sure.
I mean Aikido.
Yeah, sure.
And also, I kind of feel that when I went to Yamada Sensei Dojo, you know, there is this thing like be the perfect ushideshi.
Mm.
And it was really weird because you cannot put the Aikido on the winning cultural thing. It doesn't make any sense. But also, like you say, Aikido in Japan is different. They don't speak. They have ranks, but they see it on another way, you know. In that subject, it's like the belts, the color belts. They in Japan, they were created for kids. And when the martial arts went to other parts, it's like the way of the ranking. But the ranking didn't exist in judo. They just practiced.
Yeah. Just a couple more questions that I have on my list, and one of them is I was curious to ask about at the beginning of the documentary that you made. I really liked a place where you were, and correct me if I'm wrong, but the way I understood it, you were editing a video for this kind of religious cult thing commercial, and you mentioned that you're conflicted about doing that. And I felt like I could really like resonate with you. Like I see what you mean. I see where you're coming from. I don't think I was kind of expecting that at the end of the movie, you'll be like, so eventually I decided to do this, but I don't think you did that. So can you tell a little bit more? So how did that?
Look, I didn't understand really.
So, you know, in the beginning, what I refer to like that.
Yes.
And I was thinking, I was expecting, also to be fair, I might have missed something. I skipped a little bit of the documentary, but I think I was expecting that at the end of the documentary, you will say how the story ended with that commercial. But I don't think you did. So what
did I do? No, I did it in a way, you know?
Yeah.
Because at the end of my documentary, I say, fuck. I'm doing a big commercial about jiu-jitsu.
Okay.
Do you remember that? No.
Yeah. I think that's
and I want I really wanted to relate it with that, you know?
Yeah, okay.
I
makes
was
sense.
Making
I think you
that stuff, but you, it's like you never get rid of that, you know?
Hmm.
Is that kind of thinking that you never get rid of the clubs. Now I'm on a different club that is jiu-jitsu, but also have shit sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
That's what is also make you think that jiu-jitsu is better and maybe it's not, you know. So in a way, it was related to that, and I wanted to add that you have to struggle all the time with these things that, hey, jiu-jitsu is better than Aikido, and maybe sometimes MMA is better than jiu-jitsu, and having a gun is better than being an MMA guy, and it goes like that, you know.
Yeah, it makes sense what you're saying. I think the phrase you used, and I like that a lot, I think you mentioned like, not word to word, but basically we're saying like, I realize that what I'm saying or what's presented in this documentary sounds like a self-help book bought in a, like in the shelf, in a whatever, like what was that, like a pharmacy store.
Yeah.
And so I think, yeah, that makes sense. And so it did kind of make a full circle. But I also like what you added is that it still works. Like there is truth to it, to what you presented. And I think to me, what it makes me think about is recently on my new channel, I explored a little bit about cult mentality, like what cults are and how they work. And one of the things I realized while exploring that is that cult is not necessarily bad, because many people say when they say a cult, they already say it in a pejorative way, meaning like it's bad. But a cult is I'm inspired by a guy who's like a cult expert. And he says that there's like a Mac, you know, like Apple cult, people who love MacBooks and they're obsessed about it and obsessed about iPhones. And there's bad things to it, but it's not like entirely bad. It's like, it's their thing, you know, do your thing. It's fine. But there are also cults which trick you to get money from you and do other terrible shit. So cult is not necessarily bad, and you know, there's
even if you don't want it, you are in a cult, you know,
right?
In a way,
right?
So
I agree.
It's like a human condition,
right? And I think
we like to be together and think that we are better.
Yeah, and I think one thing which stands out for me, and I think it's similar to what you presented as well, is that being in a cult is not the problem. The problem is what influence the cult has on us, like how constructive or destructive it is. And for me personally, And I'm not saying that that the same experience has to be everywhere, but eventually, after about 15 years of being in the world of Aikido, I got a lot of good things, but also, but percentage wise, I think I got more bad things than good things eventually. Like, there's a lot of that.
Really?
Yes, but that's me personally.
Right. No, I just want to know.
Sure. Yeah. No, I can answer. I think that a lot of that is connected with my own personal journey and the context and the people I was hanging out with. My Aikido instructor was very spiritual, but in a bad way eventually. I think he wasn't a very good spiritual teacher. So that turned me off. Also, I came into Aikido expecting and needing it to be efficient as a self-defense practice.
Why?
Because I was growing up in a violent city. Like, I did get attacked and my friends got attacked. Not like, you know, every day, but I was threatened. And there were a couple of cases where I was attacked and I couldn't use Aikido. And my instructor at the day, which wasn't a very good guy either, he blamed me. You know, that it's my fault that I don't train enough. And I kind of got the same later on with my next instructor in a different way. But basically, I think the people I was hanging out with, and also my context, what I was searching for in Aikido, and what I got, and also how devoted I was. And it's also, I agree, it's partly my problem, because I was so devoted to it, I didn't critically choose what works for me and what doesn't. I was, you know, kind of like a horse with blinders. So I think that's one of the main reasons why I had eventually a bad experience with Aikido. Like there's a lot of bad things which are more on the top of my mind than the good things that I got. So, but that's my personal story. You know, not everyone is like that. So yeah.
And that's why you changed to BJJ.
To a big degree, yes. And also another aspect which added to that was because I was questioning Aikido online on YouTube, and I got frustrated that so many Aikido people hated me for that. You know, they didn't embrace that. And I think that pushed me even further to be like, I don't want to be a part of this culture which hates people who are openly questioning it. So, but you know, that's my story. I'm not saying that everyone is.
No, but I really understand you, because it's really weird that the people that really criticize Aikido are the same that are practicing. Mm. I think the other martial arts, they don't care, you know. Maybe sometimes like Joe Rogan or this kind of thing on the web. But it's, I got you what you mean, you know. Mm. Yeah. And when you practice BJJ, you feel safe on the street?
Well, to be fair, I also trained mixed martial arts, but not only mixed martial arts, but also I went through studying self-defense, like pure on self-defense theory and practice. So So that helps as well in regards to, I understand, you know, I'm aware of what's happening around, and I avoid potentially dangerous situations, and I have ideas how to de-escalate things. So that gives me confidence, but also to knowing that I can fight off a person who knows how to fight, and I can choke out a person who knows how to grapple to some degree, that definitely gives confidence. You know, because beforehand, when I did only Aikido, I didn't know if somebody will attack me. Deep inside, I knew that I don't know whether I will be able to do anything. And now when I'm used to fighting with guys who are professional fighters, it's not the same. You know, the street is different. There's weapons and there's random attacks, multiple attackers. But still, that gives confidence, because I know that I can handle a fighter. It gives me confidence that I'll fare better with a person who has no clue how to fight. So, yeah. What about yourself?
I feel safe with jiu-jitsu, but also I always want, I have to look to all the time where I'm going. I mean, Mexico City, it's a dangerous city. Yeah. And now I have a child, you know, a child. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So It's really weird. If I'm going to a neighbor that it's really dangerous, I go with a knife.
Yeah.
And I feel safe with that.
You know? Sure. Sure. Yeah. I think people who never experienced violence and people who live in places where violence is more common, they have a different relationship with that. And I think every smart person realizes that it's much more than just fighting guys off, because like, you know, Bruno Roscoe?
No.
He's a fairly well-known Aikido / like legit self-defense expert. And he lives in Mexico City. And I was talking to him once.
I know that guy.
Yeah, you know, bald guy. Tough looking. Yeah. So he said to me, you know, if you get in the way of, let's say, a cartel, no Aikido is going to help you. You know, you're screwed.
No Aikido, no jiu-jitsu.
Right, exactly. No martial art is going to save you. No. And I think some people don't understand that they still live in that fantasy of martial arts movies, where Steven Seagal takes down the whole mafia and, you know, and shit like that. It's like, no, if you get into trouble with organized crime, you're done. But the thing is, yeah, true self-defense, yeah, is making sure you don't get in their way. You don't go to places where it's dangerous at times when it's dangerous, and that's self-defense. But if I think I'm the best fighter in the world, and then I think that I can go to any dangerous area and I don't give a fuck, that's stupid. You know, that's not self-defense. I think common sense is the best means to self-defense to begin with.
Yeah, I agree.
So there's the very last part on my list, a subject, is a part I liked a lot. And I guess it's a two-parter. So the first part is, you mentioned that short story of yourself, which I personally loved, of you cutting off your sleeves of your gi, putting on a Cobra Kai patch. I loved it. But you mentioned that wasn't really accepted in the dojo, and in the Aikido dojo, which I understand, you know, it makes sense. But how was it for you? Was that a big kind of upset for you, or you didn't take it too difficult?
It was like a joke.
Okay.
It was so just like a joke, you know. But if I show you my gi of jiu-jitsu, it has a Cobra Kai patch. So it's something that I grew up with, and they should allow it. Maybe not the...
cut sleeves.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But if you want that patch, that makes the gi like more near to your heart, sure, you know? And
yeah.
I think that Aikido in some things they have to change.
Right.
Maybe not in Japan, but here in America they have to change.
Yeah.
Like those kind of thinking, like make it more practical. It's really a big subject, I know, but I think there's some competitive Aikido. I saw a video, and it was like judo. It was really similar to judo. It's just that they have kotegaeshi. But if Aikido will go to that way, it will become like really similar to judo, I think.
Could be, yeah. Well, having said all of that, I personally like that whole segment about Goku and the fictional characters. I think I kind of thought about it before, but you really made a good point that in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu that's embraced, and I think that's a brilliant point, and that's what makes it even more kind of intriguing for people, or they feel even better with doing Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, because so many of us, like I guarantee that like at least 50% of Aikidoka are geeks and nerds.
Yes, like, of course.
Right, and to kind of deny that part from them, to not allow themselves to express that way and to blend those two together, that's kind of taking away a really powerful aspect of it. So
yes,
so,
yeah. Even if you talk about that in like a commercial way,
yeah,
if they embrace that, it will be they will have more people. Sure. Or maybe not more, but more happy people, you know?
Right, yeah.
Because like you said, those things are things that belongs to you since you are a child. So if you want to put a Batman mask and train, if you want to, they should allow that. Maybe if you do it in jiu-jitsu, they would choke it with that, but they won't say you no. They will leave you to use the mask, and they will choke yourself with the mask. But
yeah,
you want to put a wrestler mask and train,
yeah,
they should allow it.
Yeah, I agree. And I think for me, the last part to this question is, so Francisco mentioned that to me, that you also like Batman, as you might know.
Yeah, sure.
I'm a big fan of Batman, also Goku and so many other things. But just that whole subject, you explored it in your documentary. So I presume you thought about that yourself. It's a big subject for me, that fictional characters, the influence fictional characters can have on us. You know, that I feel like Batman is not real, but it had a very real impact on my life, on my personal philosophy, values. And the same can be said about, you know, Spider-Man or Goku, et cetera, et cetera. So have you explored the subject, how fictional characters actually are important in our lives? And if yes, then what's the list? What's the top list for you?
I think in this subject, there's a positive part and also a negative part,
okay,
you know, because I think that there's a negative way in this subject, because if you want to rebel,
can you explain what you mean?
If you want to, let me think.
I could guess, but I'm not entirely sure what word are you looking for.
If you are in a society and you want to become like a leader, or if you are in a tough situation and you want to improve that,
yeah,
the cultural aspect that everyone has is that you just can be better if you have superpowers, or if you have a lot of money, you know what, yeah. I mean, it's really difficult to explain this.
No, I think I see your point. You know, I'm a big fan of this idea, so I guess, yeah, I mean, you know, Batman has gadgets which don't exist, and in reality he would probably die very quickly, but still, what I like is that there's the in his mythology he trains his ass off, which I think is a nice point. But I agree with you, if you take the whole narrative of superpowers and being special from birth, etc., that's not a very good message. So
yeah, if you really think about this subject, these characters,
yeah,
are our gods now.
Mm.
Because we don't think, I mean, you think in the gods, but not like before. Mm. Now it's something that it's everywhere. And I would like to speak better, but it's like it burns your conflicts now. If you see a Batman film, or if you are reading a comic, you put your problems there and you burn it there, you know?
Mm.
But in reality, it's not like that. So I think that's the negative way.
Right.
The positive way is also that you can burn your frustrations there.
Yeah.
and don't think about yourself. But the characters are always changing. I mean, now I really love Rick and Morty, you know?
Yeah.
And they are not heroes. They are like sick people, you know?
Like all of us. Yeah. I guess that's
then that's more reality.
Yeah.
But having these characters, fictional characters, sometimes helps you, sometimes it doesn't. I think it has both sides.
Yeah.
I don't know if that was your question.
Yeah, no, entirely. I think, yeah, it really depends on how you look at it. And I think you said you articulated your point well enough, but the only thing which comes to my mind is I think one of the theories I have is that the reason superhero movies are so big these days, you know, both Marvel and DC, it's such a huge industry, but that's because, and that's only my personal theory, but that people want to be the hero of their story. They want to make a difference. They want to be significant. And because most people are not, they don't feel that way in their lives. They feel powerless. They try to kind of satisfy that hunger, that feeling by watching those movies, by feeling like a part of that story. And I think it's great. I think it's awesome. And hopefully some of those people are inspired to change at least a little bit, to do at least something a little bit in their lives. But at the same time, I think too many people just go to the movie, see the movie, get back, and they go back right back to the same place they were before. So I wish
I think it has both sides of the coin, you know?
Yeah.
Because, you know, the life of everybody knows what happened to Batman. But not everybody knows who is Pancho Villa or who is Che Guevara, you know?
Right.
So that's what I think, that it has both sides of the coin.
I guess it's everything, but in the end for me, I guess I stick with the idea that as long as people are capable of taking good things from it, like I made a video about me overtraining because of Dragon Ball Z. That was not very good for me. Like, I still have, you know, knee problems and this and that because of that. So it inspired me to train, but it didn't tell me about correct training. So I guess it depends on what you take from it. So.
Yeah, I'm agree.
But then, very last point then, something I mentioned but we didn't get into. So top three characters you choose that influenced you most.
Of course, Dragon Ball.
Yeah.
Batman. Three, right?
Yeah, give me one more.
I don't know.
What comes
it's
to
it's just you? I still seeing cartoons, you know, when I have time. But sure. Maybe Ninja Turtles.
Okay. Yeah. Nice. Cool.
Yeah.
Cool. I'm a big Batman nerd, and one of my best friends is a Ninja Turtles fan. So you're a combination of us both. But cool. Well,
I still reading comics.
Yeah, me too. Not as much as I used to, but for sure. And these days, do you know Attack on Titan? Shingeki no Kyojin?
Yeah.
I just watched it for the second time because my girlfriend hasn't seen it, and I enjoyed it so much. I was like, oh, you know, maybe I should show you this anime. But actually, like, the truth was I wanted to watch it for a second time. Obviously, it was nice for me to show it to her, but I was like, yeah, it was so good. I love it. Anyway, well, good. So for the very end, well, actually, I have some ideas. After we finish on record, I'll ask you something about the video off record. But just in case, so I'll leave the link in the video here to your documentary.
Okay, sure. Thank you.
If anybody, you know, it's definitely worth watching it. And is there anything else like your Vimeo channel or something, if people want to learn more about you and your work, where should they go?
I just threw up my Facebook page because I don't have much time now because I'm a father.
Yeah.
But I will send you the link of my Instagram.
Cool. Sounds good. So I'll put that in as well.
Yeah. Cool.